Hello friends, last time we have explained about the composition and the uses of the silk together with biotechnological and biomedical applications of the silk. This is the image showing silk garment which is prepared by using a fabric. That is a silk. So this is a silk garment prepared by using the silk material as a product of the sericulture. Then this is the image showing the ladies who are involved in making different ornamental commodities or the decorative commodities which are useful for the ornamental purpose or decorative purpose for various commodities like purses, dolls, or even the for the preparation of these silk flowers for the decorative purpose. And this is prepared from the rejected silk. So the cocoons which are rejected, that is double cocoons, pierced cocoons, flimsy cocoons, or irregular cocoons, which are sorted out and rejected from the good stock of the cocoons, are mainly used for the preparation of these ornamental or decorative commodities by using the poor quality of the silk. And which is unreliable silk, which is unreliable silk. Only good quality cocoons are sold in the market and are reeled into a raw silk mechanically. But the rejected silk cocoons, which are used for the preparation of these ornamental or decorative commodities, that is transformation of garbage into gold. So one can use the rejected cocoons also for the various purposes, that is for the ornamental purpose or decorative purpose, and various type of commodities can be used by using the silk which is of poor quality or obtained from the rejected cocoons, that is conversion of garbage to gold. So today we are going to explain important diseases and the pest of the sericulture. Since the mulberry silk moth is a completely domesticated insect, and thus the silkworm larvae are cultured or grown in the rearing house for the purpose of obtaining a crop in the form of cocoons so as to obtain the raw silk. So as the insect Bombyx mori or a silk moth Bombyx mori is a popular species of the silk moth and is cultured or grown on a large scale, on a commercial scale, for the production of raw silk in India and all over world. And we know about 90% of the silk produced in India and abroad belongs to mulberry type. And thus, the insect silk moth Bombyx mori, which is a popular silk moth cultured or grown for the purpose or practice of sericulture so as to obtain the commercial quantity of the raw silk or a commercial production of raw silk, the mulberry sericulture is practiced all over the world and even in India. And since it is a completely domesticated type of insect, It is grown in the rearing house. So larvae are cultured or grown in the rearing house. And since these are domesticated type that are very sensitive, the silkworm larvae or the caterpillars of the silk moth Bombyx mori are very sensitive and susceptible to the different unfavorable climatic conditions. They are very susceptible and sensitive to various abiotic factors, that is temperature, humidity. When there is a fluctuation or change in the environmental conditions, that is also affecting the growth and the development of the silkworm larvae. Similarly, there are various type of pathogens like protozoans, fungi, bacteria, viruses, and all these type of pathogens or the disease causing agents which are infecting the silkworm larvae and the adults also, and causing variety of diseases and leading into the death of larvae, and thus reducing the number of larvae in the rearing house. So whenever there is an infection in the rearing house causing the death of larvae and reducing their number, so this is the ultimate loss of the crop or the cocoons. So whenever there is an occurrence of disease or the infection of disease in the rearing house leading into the death of larvae, and due to the death of larvae there is an ultimate decrease in the number of larvae and ultimately the decrease in the cocoons. So ultimately we'll have a loss of cocoons due to the attack or the infection of different type of pathogens or the disease causing agents. So in the sericulture, the different type of diseases and the pathogens are having great importance as far as the number of larvae or the development of larvae in the rearing house is concerned, so as to have a good number of larvae or good quantity of cocoons that should be harvested at the end of sericultural practice. And thus the sericulturist or the farmer has to take care for the prevention of infection of different pathogens and the disease causing agents, so as to protect the larval stock or the silkworm larvae which are growing in the rearing house, so as to avoid the infections. Because the heavy toll or the loss of the crop or the loss of silkworm larvae can occur due to the variety of infections, and thus while the continued practice or the regular practice of sericulture or the mulberry sericulture, it is essential to study the various type of diseases which are attacking onto the silkworm larvae and causing the loss of sericulture or a loss of crop of the cocoons in the sericulture. So today we are going to explain diseases of silkworms. So first, silkworm disease, which we explained today, that is a protozoan disease. So protozoan disease caused due to a pathogen or the parasite belongs to phylum protozoa, and disease caused is called as pebrine. So pebrine is a protozoan disease caused due to a protozoan parasite or a pathogen, namely Anosema bombicis. So the Anosema bombicis is a protozoan parasite and causing disease epebrin. The infection occurs through the ingestion of spores and the infected eggs. So mode of infection of the protozoan disease pebrin or the Nosema bombicis occurs through the ingestion or the intake of a contaminated leaves of the mulberry containing spores, which might be released by the infected larvae. So feces of the infected silkworms or the caterpillars can release the feces, which may contain the spores of the Nosema bombicis. So can spoil the feed bed and can contaminate the mulberry leaves. So such contaminated or infected leaves containing spores of the Nosema bombicis, when fed by the silkworm larvae, can get infected. So the mode of infection, one of the mode of infection of the silkworm larvae is through the contaminated mulberry leaves containing spores of the Nosema bombicis. Then another mode of infection, that is infected eggs. So when the eggs are laid by the females, that can also be get spoiled or contaminated with the feces of the infected larvae or the infected adults. So infected adult or infected larvae can release the feces containing the spores of the Nosema bombicis, and this can infect the eggs. So when the eggs get infected readily prior to the development into a larvae, prior to development of larvae, the eggs when get infected by the spores of Nosema bombicis, the larvae ultimately get infected. So eggs can also be infected by the spores of Nosema bombicis, and this will lead to the infection of larvae which are hatching from these eggs. So infection occurs in all stages of the life cycle. In case of Bombyx mori, all the stages of life cycle, that is egg, larva, pupa and adult. These are the four stages of life cycle of Bombyx mori, and all of which are infected by the protozoan parasite or the spores of protozoan parasite Nosema bombicis. So when the eggs are infected, they show some symptoms. That is, eggs are poor sticking. That is, that will not remain stuck or adhered to the egg card sheet, but they are separate. Eggs are separate or they do not stick to the egg card sheet when laid by the mated females or fertilized females. So eggs are poor sticking. Then mostly eggs remain unfertilized. So whenever the eggs are infected by the spores of Nosema bombicis, they cannot fertilize. So eggs remain unfertilized, and such eggs can get died or dead due to the infection of the spores of the Nosema bombicis. Means when the eggs are infected, they are poor sticking, usually remain unfertilized and can be died or dead eggs. So this will be the condition. This will be the condition happening with the eggs due to the infection of the Nosema bombicis or the spores of Nosema bombicis. Then in case of larvae, when larvae get infected, when the contaminated mulberry leaves, when the mulberry leaves contaminated with the spores of Nosema bombicis are consumed by the larvae and they get infected by the Nosema bombicis, so such larvae become shows they are abnormal and they shows the black spots on the body. If there are irregular black spots or specks formed onto the skin surface together with wrinkled body, then poor appetite. When the silkworm larvae are infected by spores of Nosema bombicis, they shows abnormal growth, resulting into poor appetite. They lose their appetite, means they do not feed much, and they become inactive. The larvae become sluggish or inactive, means they do not show much of the movements, and thus this may lead to the death of larvae, and this may lead to the dysentery or omitting type of symptoms in the larvae. So the infected larvae, they shows black spots on the body, then wrinkled body, losing appetite, means they do not feed or consume much of the mulberry leaves, and shows the sluggish nature, or they become inactive, means they do not show much movements, they do not feed properly, and such larvae can show the symptoms of the dysentery, that is omitting and dysentery type of symptoms can occur in the larvae, or may lead to the death of larvae, and this will ultimately reduce the number of larvae in the rearing house. Then when the pupa are infected by the spores of Nosema, resulting into a swollen abdomen and darkened body, means there is a discoloration of the body in case of pupa or swollen pupa. The body becomes small, swollen, the pupa becomes swollen or with a darkened body or discoloration of the body due to the infection of the spores of Nosema bombicis, and resulting into the death of pupae also. Then in case of adults, when adult moths of the Bombyx mori get infected by the spores of Nosema bombicis, resulting into swollen abdomen, unstretched or malformed wings, and poor egg laying capacity. So when the adult females get infected by the Nosema bombicis, resulting into a febrine disease or a protozoan disease, they shows a swollen abdomen, malformed wings or unstretched wings, together with a poor egg laying capacity, means this will affect badly with the breeding activity or reproductive activity of the female moths whenever there is a infection of the protozoan Nosema bombicis, resulting into a resulting into the bad effect onto the development of ovary also, and will lead into non-production or rate of production of ova in the ovary is also reduced. This will lead into a poor egg laying capacity of the females. So all the stages, egg, larva, pupa and adult, all the four stages of the life cycles in case of Bombyx mori can infected by the spores of protozoan parasite or pathogen, namely Nosema bombicis, and resulting into a febrine disease. So for the control of disease, we can employ some activities, that is use of disease free females and eggs. So for the control of febrine disease in the sericulture, we'll have to use the disease free laying seeds, disease free laying seeds, or the adult males and females for the production of eggs or the disease free eggs can only be used for the purpose of sericulture or for the purpose of hatching larvae. So egg stock, whatever we are using for the purpose of obtaining silkworm larvae so as to culture or rear them or grow them in the rearing house for the purpose of sericulture, we should use the disease-free female sand eggs. Then sterilization of the eggs. Whatever the eggs obtained or brought to the rearing house for the purpose of hatching or incubation of egg card seeds or the eggs in the rearing house, that should be first sterilized. So sterilization of the eggs, sterilization of the equipments, sterilization of the rearing room and the workers with a 2% formalin. So this is one of the major for the control of Pebrin disease. Then destruction of infected seeds and females. Destruction of infected seeds and the females means whenever there is a occurrence of Pebrin disease in a particular season or in a particular region during the practice of sericulture, one should identify and one should separate these infected seeds or infected adult moths and female adult moths, that is males and females, adult moths, males and females, which are infected or suffering from a Pebrin disease should be identified and should be destroyed and should not be used. Such infected adult males and females should not be used for the breeding purpose so as to obtain the eggs for the purpose of sericulture. So these are the some of the control measures, that is use of disease free females, use of disease free females and eggs for the purpose of obtaining silkworm larvae for the purpose of sericultural practice. Then sterilization of the eggs, sterilization of rearing equipments, sterilization of rearing room and the workers by using 2% formalin will also help to avoid the infection of the protozoan disease Pebrin in the rearing house. And thirdly, the destruction of infected seeds and the females. So whatever the adult males and females which are suffering from a Pebrin disease should not be used for the propagation purpose or the breeding purpose. So we'll have to destroy the infected seeds and the females, means infected eggs or infected adult females should not be used for obtaining the eggs or a seed for the purpose of sericultural practice. Then another disease or a infection occurring in the silkworm larvae, that is the muscardine disease. So muscardine disease is a fungal disease. It is caused by the fungal pathogens on the basis of color of the spores and the etiology, that is the mode of infection and the symptoms produced, on the basis of mode of infection and the symptoms produced, that is etiology of these fungal pathogens. There are different type of muscardines have been identified in the silkworms. So muscardine disease is the fungal disease and is caused due to a fungal pathogen or variety of fungi, and on the basis of color of the spores, fungal spores, on the basis of the color of the spores or the fungal spores and the etiology. Etiology means a mode of infection and the symptoms produced by the particular type of fungus. There are different types of muscardine which are identified in the silkworms, such as white muscardine, green muscardine, yellow muscardine, black muscardine, red muscardine, purple red muscardine, orange muscardine, or a brown muscardine, which can also be called as aspergillosis. So there are several type of muscardine or the fungal diseases occurring in the silkworm larvae and which are identified on the basis of the color of the spores, color of the fungal spores which develops onto the silkworm larvae which are infected by the muscardine disease or the fungal disease. So muscardine disease is a fungal disease and it is caused due to the fungal pathogens, and there are several species or the types of the fungal pathogens which are attacking the silkworm larvae and cause the muscardine disease. So on the basis of the color of the fungal spores and the etiology, that is the mode of infection and the symptoms produced due to the different type of fungi, there are different type of muscardines which are identified in the silkworms of the Bombyx mori, and these are subdivided into white muscardine, green muscardine, yellow muscardine, black muscardine, red muscardine, purple red muscardine, orange muscardine, or a brown muscardine, and this brown muscardine can be called as aspergillosis. So these are the several type of muscardines have been identified in the silkworms on the basis of a pathogens or the fungal pathogens, and which are causing a fungal disease onto the silkworm larvae and leading into the development or formation of symptoms, development of muscardine or symptoms of the disease, and causing death of the silkworm larvae and reducing the number of silkworm larvae, and ultimately causing a loss of crop or reducing in a reduction in number of the silkworm larvae and ultimate reduction in a number of cocoon or quantity of cocoon is also reduced due to the muscardine disease. So there are different pathogens which are causing the muscardine disease. The white muscardine caused due to Beveria bassiana. So genus species of the fungus, namely Beveria bassiana, causing white muscardine. Spicaria farinosa, causing green muscardine. Escaria farinosa, causing yellow muscardine. Aspergillus flavus, causing brown muscardine, or is also called as aspergillosis. Sporosporilla juvela, causing red muscardine. Spicaria rubida, causing purple red muscardine. Stigmatocystis japonica, causing orange muscardine. Beveria brongniarity, causing black muscardine. Penicillium citrinum, causing penicillosis. So these are the several fungal pathogens and causing different type of muscardine. So these are the list of genus and species of the fungal pathogens and causing different type of muscardine. I will repeat the names of all these fungal pathogens and the type of muscardine disease occurring in the silkworm larvae of the Bombyx mori, and they are Viverria bassiana causing white muscardine, Spicaria farinosa causing green muscardine, Ischaria farinosa causing yellow muscardine, Aspergillus flavus causing brown muscardine, then Sporosporilla euhela causing red muscardine, Spicaria rubida causing purple red muscardine, then Stigmatocystis japonica causing orange muscardine, Viverria brongniarti causing black muscardine, and Penicillium citrinum causing a penicillosis. So these are the different type of muscardine diseases caused due to different fungi or the fungal pathogens and causing damage of the silkworm larvae or leading into the death of silkworm larvae of the Bombyx mori. So out of all these type of muscardine diseases, white muscardine, green muscardine, yellow muscardine and a brown muscardine, that is aspergillosis, are important. That will cause heavy toll or heavy loss of the silkworm larvae due to the muscardine disease or the fungal disease. Means out of all these muscardine, only four type of muscardines are important or serious and causing much of the loss of the silkworm larvae or damage to the silkworm larvae due to these only four type of muscardines, that is white muscardine, green muscardine and yellow muscardine, and fourth one, that is aspergillosis, or it is also called as a brown muscardine. So in the list of the type of muscardine, first four type of muscardine are important, that is white, green, yellow and the aspergillosis. So these are the different type of fungal pathogens and causing the muscardine disease among the silkworm larvae and causing the loss of or damage of silkworm larvae and resulting into the reduction in the number of larvae and reduction in the ultimate production of cocoons due to the muscardine disease. Then regarding mode of infection of the muscardine. So muscardine infection occurs due to the germinating spores and the conidia, which are penetrating through the skin of larvae. So mode of infection means infection of muscardine disease occurs by germinating spores and the conidia, which penetrates through the skin of larvae. Infection is found in larva, pupa and adult. So all the stages of the life cycle, that is larva, pupa and adult, get suffer from the infection of the muscardine disease. Infection is found in larva, pupa and adults. All the stages of the life cycle are suffering from the infection of muscardine disease, and the infection mainly occurs due to the germinating spores and conidia, which penetrates through the skin of larvae. Then regarding the symptoms of the muscardine, symptoms of disease shows the hyphae come out from the intersegmental membranes of the larvae, then limpness, that is hardness, vomiting and the diarrhea. So these are the important symptoms of the muscardine disease. So whenever there is an infection of the fungal spores, whenever there is an infection of the fungal spores in the silkworm larvae, the fungal spores germinate into the hyphae or mycelia, that is branching, rebranching of the fungal strands, and will develop into a fungal molds. So whenever the fungal spores getting entry into the body of silkworm larvae, when the fungal spores get entry into the body of silkworm larvae, resulting into their germination and formation of a mycelia or the fungal strands or the hyphae, resulting into a development of fungal molds or the fungal strands. So that will develop from the germinating spores. So germinating spores of the fungus, resulting into the development of the mycelia or hyphae, that is branching, rebranching of the fungal strands, and resulting into the formation of fungal molds. So that can acquire entire body cavity, that can acquire entire body cavity of the silkworm larvae, and these hyphae or fungal strands can release out from the intersegmental membranes or intersegmental regions of the silkworm larvae, and this will result into the death of larvae. This will result into a death of larvae, and larvae become limp or hardness. So the hardness of the skin, limpness or hardening of the skin of the silkworm larvae will occur due to the growth of fungal molds, due to the growth of fungal molds of the strands onto the silkworm larvae or onto the surface of the skin. And the larvae also shows vomiting and the diarrhea type of symptoms. Larvae shows vomiting and diarrhea type of symptoms together with a growth of fungal molds or the fungal strands onto the body surface or onto the skin, resulting into limpness or hardening of the body wall. And this is due to the development or establishment of the fungal molds onto the larval body. So symptoms of the disease shows hyphae, which comes out from the intersegmental membranes of the larvae or through the intersegmental membranes, and this will result into a development of fungal molds onto the body of silkworm larvae. So the mode of infection is through the oral ingestion also. So contaminated leaves or the mulberry leaves, when contaminated with the fungal spores, get entry into the body of larva, then reaches to the alimentary canal, from where the fungal spores, they get germinate and result into the formation of fungal strands, which will then penetrate out through the digestive tract into the body cavity and can acquire the entire body cavity by a fungal mold or the fungal strands. So from where this can release out or penetrate out in from the regions of the intersegmental regions or a intersegmental grooves of the body segments, and then release out and then develop into a fungal mold or the fungal strands. So on maturity of these fungal strands or the fungi, result into a formation of conidia or the fungal spores, which are having different colors, maybe white color, green color, yellow color, red color, brown color, orange color. So on the basis of the colors of the fungal spores and the conidia, the muscardine disease or a fungal disease can be identified on the basis of the color of the fungal spores and the etiology, that is mode of infection and the development of the symptoms of the disease, occurrence of the symptoms of the disease. So in case of muscardine disease, the infection can occur by means of spores or conidia, which are contaminating the mulberry leaves, or simply can be fungal strands when there is a development of the fungals in the rearing house or in the feed bed, can also lead to the infection of the larvae. Means the surface of the silkworm larvae can also getting infected by the fungal spores, or there may be the entry of fungal spores through the contaminated leaves in the body of silkworm larvae and resulting into the development of a fungal strands or the hyphae or mycelia on maturity, which can develop a conidia containing the fungal spores. So the symptoms of the disease are: the larvae shows hyphae which come out from the intersegmental membranes, and this will lead to the hardening of the larvae or surface or the body wall of the larvae get hardened. Then larvae also shows vomiting and diarrhea type of symptoms. Larvae also shows vomiting and diarrhea type of symptoms. So for the control of muscardine disease, proper rearing of the larvae and sterilization of the rearing room, equipments and the worker is essential. So for the control or the muscardine, we'll have to take care of the disinfection or the sterilization of the larvae, rearing room, equipments and workers is essential. So this is about the muscardine disease. So today we'll stop here. Next time we'll explain the bacterial diseases. So today we'll stop here. So next time we'll continue with the bacterial